And we're only going to be in about three verses in Galatians today, same part that we've been in for a while, but I'll go ahead and give you the verses, Galatians 2, 14 through 16. I'll go ahead and read them. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou being a Jew livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Jews to live as, or the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. We have been looking at the story here with Peter and Paul. Paul standing to the face. You know the setting. Paul, Peter, they're in fellowship with the Gentiles. Here come the Jews. Paul or Peter, because of fear, left. So we got to go in here and look at this and I think what we're going to look at here a lot is that term, the flesh, and then Jews by nature, not sinners of the Gentiles. That's kind of where we're going to be. Because I've always, that term flesh, man, every preacher uses that term, flesh, yeah, the flesh. And I know what it's always referred to. It's referred to the flesh is when I'm thinking about fishing or politics or movies or something else. But you're going to see today, I hope, that when Paul says flesh, he is specific about what he's talking about. You know, just like in when we talked about this present evil world, the one who might deliver us from this present evil world, we've got to keep that in context, and we can't bring that over in Paul forecasting of the time we're living in, because the present evil world of Paul was what was going on then, and we looked at that, what it was. It was Judaism. It was Judaism. It wasn't. You know, God keep me from the movie house or none of that stuff. We're gonna look at this. I'm looking at my paper to make sure I'm on the right one here. Yeah. Jews by nature. Paul is going to show here that what Peter's doing, what the absurdity of it is. To step out of fellowship with the Gentiles and go back. Now you got to stay with me on this, to what I'm going to call it, the righteousness of the Jews. Because the Jews thought they had a righteousness. It's the same thing as when he in verse 14, thou livest after the manner of the Gentiles, and not as do the Jews. Why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? He says this. I mean, here's the only thing that matters. Galatians 6 and 15, for in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything. What is the circumcision? He's talking about Jews. Nor uncircumcision. It doesn't avail anything either. So he's got Jews and Gentiles. What availeth? But a new creature, a new creation. Neither one of them availeth anything. But we got to look at it. We got to see what we're talking about. Because this whole thing we had talked about was a matter of conscience with Peter. We looked at an evil conscience versus a good conscience. And that evil conscience was simply a consciousness that was fixed, had a salvation fixed in the wrong man. And when I say fixed in the wrong man, you, me. Salvation based on what I do or what I don't do or what I've done. That's an evil conscience because it's a conscience based on works. And a good conscience, man, he's solely established in the faith of Jesus Christ. A good conscience knows that Christ is our life. Christ liveth in me. So here in verse 15, we who are Jews by nature. I mean, here's the picture. Here's Paul looking at Peter, who is going back to the law through the fear of the circumcision, through the fear of the Jews. He's now presenting to those that have a weak conscience and to those that are being swayed. What's the word he used? Dissimulation. They're carried away. They're swayed. Peter is doing this with his actions, not his words, his actions. By Peter's actions, he's saying it is necessary to abstain from eating certain meats. Now, why do I say that? Because they were in fellowship, and this is what they did. They got together and ate. I mean, you go read Acts, and you can see the whole thing is they were always talking about, well, don't eat this, don't eat that. Peter knew, we talked about this earlier, so now Peter's having a pork chop. Here comes the Jews. Peter didn't say nothing about the pork chop, but he got up and left. And now all those with a weak conscience are being swayed and following Peter. And see, that's vital to understand and get this picture. It's vital to the argument Paul presents, because how does he start this argument out? We who are Jews by nature, and not sinners of the Gentiles. He's speaking of their natural origin here. You know that. I mean, that's pretty self-explanatory. He said that we were born Jews. Now, yeah, they were Jewish proselytes. We read that in Matthew. The Jews went about to make proselytes. What did Jesus say? You make them twofold more child of hell than they were to start with. Let me go over there to Matthew just a quick second. I want to show you something here. Matthew 23. We don't think about this. Matthew 23 is a whole chapter of woes. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses. For pretense make long prayer, therefore you receive the greater damnation. Woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, you come to sea and land to make one proselyte. When he's made, you make him twofold more child of hell. Woe to you, blind guides, which say, who shall swear by the temple is nothing, but who shall swear by the gold of the temple is a debtor. You fools. Look at all these things he says here. Now, the disciples are there with him. I mean, he goes on. He says, thou blind Pharisees. You know, the white sepulchres, it's full of dead men's bones. It's full of iniquity. It's full of uncleanness. Did you ever read chapter 24? Man, everybody in the church read Matthew 24. But now, just think about this. Jesus is describing to them the state of their being that's going on. All uncleanness and blindness and full of dead men's bones and how ugly it is. He said, you make the outside of the cup pretty, but on the inside it's ugly. Full of dead men's bones. But the disciples don't get it, so what do they say in chapter 24? So the disciples, they wanted to bring Jesus up to the temple to show him the beauty of the temple. And Jesus just told them, my God, Do you not understand what I'm telling you? I want you to get that picture. Now we're gonna come back to that a little bit. It was crazy. I mean, Jesus just told him, I don't care what the outside looks like, it's the inside. So here is Paul back here saying, we who are Jews by nature. What did Jesus just say about these Jews by nature? Paul is emphatic when saying, by birth, they're Jews by nature. Meaning, they were brought up from childhood in the Jews' religion. Brought up in the law of Moses. The natural seed of Abraham. He's declaring a pedigree here. When Paul makes a statement, we who are Jews by nature, he's declaring a pedigree. The same pedigree the Jews used to tell Jesus, we're the sons of Abraham. And now when Paul says, and not sinners of the Gentiles, Paul is using the language of the Judaizers. Because the Judaizers called the Gentiles sinners, called them dogs, called them unclean, called them heathen. And the point was, it was not what the Gentiles did, but it was who they were. Do you see what I'm making a contrast here? The Jews by birth said, we're righteous. We're God's people. And the Gentiles by birth, the Jews said, you're dogs. Just by birth. No actions on either part here. But who they are. And the Jews felt that they were righteous because they had the law. The laws given of God on Mount Sinai to Moses and given to them. And they felt the Gentiles were defiled simply because they did not have the law. So Paul is utilizing the argument here. He's using their own language here to strengthen the argument that he's about to make. And that word sinner will be very important when we get to verse 17 here in Galatians, but not today. And you know, we always got to keep and understand the perspective of the work that had already taken place and was ever ongoing taking place in Paul's heart. When it pleased God, who did what? Separated me from my mother's womb. What did he say right here? We who are Jews by nature, natural born. Right? Now he's referring back. When it pleased God, who did what? Separated me from my mother's womb to reveal his son in me. This is a work that had taken place in Paul. It was a true work. What took place? Separated from his mother's womb. Who was his mother? His mother was Old Covenant Israel, Old Covenant Judaism, his natural lineage, the system, the religion, but also, now listen, but also the privilege of being a Jew by birth. Paul was separated from the privilege of being a Jew by birth. And you say, what privilege? I didn't think there was a privilege. Oh yeah, we're going to see it. Separated. How was he separated? By coming to the true enjoyment of the advantage he possessed as a natural born Jew. It makes no sense, does it? But it will. In this confrontation with Peter, he's saying, Peter, don't you realize that we had the law and the prophets from birth? But when it comes to standing before God, in truth and salvation and righteousness and justification, we couldn't rely on this identification, this natural distinction. And why is he making such a big deal of this? So let's go to Romans chapter 9. Verse 1, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. Here's that word flesh again, isn't it? We always thought flesh was going fishing or skipping church, or right? But now we're starting to see, according to the flesh, who are Israelites. Here's why he's making this point. To whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service of God, which is the priesthood, and the promises? This is why he's making such a big deal. This is what the natural Jew had. Gentiles didn't have the prophets. Gentiles didn't have a priesthood. Gentiles didn't have the glory. Gentiles didn't have the covenants. The Jews had it. Just by being a natural born Jew, this is what they had. Whose are the fathers of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel. He's making a distinction here. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are of the children of the flesh. Do you see how brutalized that word flesh is used today? When Paul's talking about flesh, he's talking about natural Israel. These are not. Listen, let me just read that again. That is, they which are the children of the flesh. Now, who are we talking about, children of the flesh? Natural Israel. Natural. These are not the children of God. You can't read that. You can't read that verse right there and run for an office in the United States. You can't. All right, you got to leave that verse out. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise, are counted for the seed. I mean, he's telling Peter, you can't rely on being a natural Jew. You're missing the whole point here, Peter. Look at Romans 30, or 9, Romans 9, 30 and 31. Now remember what we just read. The natural children of the flesh are not counted for the seed. And then here he's summing it up. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles which followed not after righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, hath not attained to the law of righteousness. Paul is saying to us, as natural born Jews, we had been given by God the testimony of the law and the prophets and the glory and the covenants and the priesthood, but it was all given as a testimony. But the testimony has effect, because now God has said that it will not just be given to those of the natural born Jews, not just to them, it will be to those who are born of the seed. Now he's talking about another seed. Remember, Abraham said, all that Ishmael might live before you. We just read, not those of the flesh, but those of the promise. Now look, let me go back to that. The children of the promise, the children of the promise are counted for the seed. Now, let me just interject this. You guys will already know this, but for whoever may be listening, for the sake of them, the promise we've come to see was not a thing. The promise is a man. It was all summed up in a man. So can you see here what we're talking about? The children of the promise are counted for the seed. He, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, is the promise. And here in Romans it says, the Gentiles which followed not. Now notice that word follow there. They didn't pursue this thing. The Jews followed the law of righteousness. The Gentiles didn't follow nothing. They didn't pursue nothing. They had no zeal towards anything. They didn't even know God. They had all these gods on the hill. They didn't know the true God. But the Jews did. They followed with great zeal. Look at Romans 10:2. For I bear them record. They have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. They have a zeal, but they're ignorant. Now the Gentiles didn't pursue after nothing. Now that word pursue means there with zeal, it's a pursuit with hostility. And what is that? That's the law. Now they went about to establish their own righteousness. What was the basis of their own righteousness? Just be born a Jew. That was it. Remember Paul? What was Paul? Paul was a Pharisee of Pharisees. You remember what the word Pharisee meant? Separated. Why was Paul separated from the Gentiles? Why would Paul persecute the Gentiles? Why was persecuting any Jew that was following after Christ? Because of the hostility of the law, of the self-righteousness that it had produced in him. That's why Paul separated. Paul had the law. What Paul is telling Peter here is, Peter, we're all on equal ground here, brother. Yeah, we were natural born Jews. Yeah, we had a pedigree. Yeah, we had... And here's these Gentiles who were just sinners, what you call them sinners. But let me tell you something here. We're all on equal ground here. We're all on equal ground. We greater than the flesh of a Gentile. Now remember, back over here in Galatians, what he said. Remember that word flesh. Galatians 2:16, and not by works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. I can say it by this, for by the works of the law shall no Jew be justified. You see what we do with the word flesh now, right? How we put it in all these other things and all this. But we got to keep in context what Paul has talked about. Because the works of the law is always towards what? Justifying the flesh, the keeping of the law, observing me standing before God in my own merits, instead of partaking of Christ, who is the righteousness of God. Paul is saying, Peter, we're all equally dependent and in need of the life of another, in need of the life that this testimony testified of, because it didn't testify of Jews, it didn't testify of Gentiles, it testified of Jesus Christ. Does that not sound like what Paul's fixing to get ready and say in Galatians 2:20? I'm crucified with Christ because, remember, separated me from my mother's womb. Jews by birth, pedigree, advantage. Now, you remember Nicodemus? everybody remembers Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a Pharisee. Nicodemus come by night to the Lord. Jesus said, you must be born again. If you're not born from above, you can't even see the kingdom. Remember Nicodemus' response. How can a man, he's grown, enter again into his mother's womb? And why would he say it that way? I keep in mind, Paul, separated from a mother's womb. They call Jerusalem their mother. Now see, us Christians, we always think of it differently, don't we? But we got to understand, this is a Jew talking here. He's talking about his mother, Jerusalem. Galatians, does that not talk about that? Jerusalem, which now is in bondage. But Jerusalem, which is above, is what? Free and the mother of us all? So Nicodemus is posing this question back to Jesus. How can I enter again into my mother's womb the second time? Why would he say it that way? Because to a natural Jew, to a Nicodemus, to them, they were already born into the kingdom. Why do you think it was such a contrast when Jesus said, the kingdom of his heaven is at hand? And they thought, we're the kingdom of heaven. We're the children of Abraham, Jesus. We're the kingdom. We're just waiting on King David's son to come down through here and set this thing up again, but we're already here. And so Nicodemus is posing the same question and saying, what do you mean I can't see the kingdom except I be born again? We're already Jews. We're already God's chosen people. Isn't that what all Christianity thinks? All the Jews are God's special people? And we're just getting the leftovers? That was their concept. Their concept was, I'm of the kingdom. Abraham is my father. But what did Jesus say? It wasn't about Jew and Gentile, but he made the distinction, didn't he? He said, that is born of the flesh is flesh. Now, just remember what we read in Romans. That's born of the Spirit is spirit. These two don't mingle. You don't take the old garment and put it into the new. You don't take old new wine and put it in old bottles. He's making a distinction here between the natural and the spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthy. Flesh never becomes spirit. But the spirit of life living in me is what being born again is. It's not me being born again or born from above. It's Christ living in me as the new. What, remember we read in Galatians? Circumcision availeth nothing, neither uncircumcision, but a new creature, a new creation. That new creation is Christ. That's born again. And see, when this change comes, it's a change of covenant. It's a change of administration. This is what he's attempted to bring Peter and those that were with him to this understanding. Now back here in Romans 9:30, it says the Gentiles which followed not, they wasn't pursuing anything. They didn't follow after righteousness, but they have attained to it. That word attained there means to arrive at a particular state of being. But it also means this. It means to anticipate something and then to arrive at what the anticipation was. The Gentiles had no hope. Paul tells us in Ephesians, you that were aliens had no hope. They had no expectation. They wasn't waiting on a Messiah to come. But now Paul is saying they didn't have an expectation, but yet they've attained. And he said the Jews who had expectation have not attained because they followed after the works of the law and didn't receive it by faith. The Jews chose rather the outward observances of the law the things that they had by birth rather than receive Jesus. They chose the things that they had by birth. They were ignorant, not realizing that what they had received from Moses was a testimony. Even in the scriptures, it was called the Ark of the Testimony. They rejected Christ and applied those things to themselves. It's what Christians do today. Jesus to them is just a little bit of help. He's not their life. They applied those things to themselves. Followed after the law. Seeking righteousness and justification from it. Paul says they did not obtain. They were ignorant of the meaning and the purpose that the law was given to them. Now, let me show you something in Romans chapter 3. Now remember we talked about Paul saying, we're natural born Jews. Now here in Romans 3, what advantage then hath the Jew, or what profit is there of circumcision? Much every way. So Paul's about to say something. Remember, when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb, there was a pedigree here. There was a heritage here. Paul is about to tell us it was of great advantage. People don't realize that. But yes, the Jews had an advantage, Paul says, much every way. Chiefly because that unto them, to who? The Jew, were committed the oracles of God. But see, there's no true advantage to those to whom the oracles of God was given, unless they come to be found in the one of whom it spoke. They thought it spoke of them. That's why most people read the Bible and they think it's talking about you. It's not. It's a testimony. I was thinking of this today. This guy come on the radio and he said, I'm going to send you a book, 101 Last Days Prophecies. Everybody was calling in on that book. And I thought, my Lord and my God, if they would read all these prophecies, they would see these prophecies pointed to Jesus Christ. And even in the book of Revelation, I just see it. It says the spirit of prophecy is what? The testimony of Jesus Christ. My Lord. People are looking at things just like the Jews did. They look at things instead of look for Him. And see, there's now no advantage to the Jew if they don't come to the one of whom it speaks. He says back in all that in Romans, the Gentiles didn't have any heritage of pedigree. They didn't have one. They received the gospel by faith, realizing they didn't have anything. Realizing they stood in need of something. I mean, what was the difference? The Jews, they set their affection in the law. Now, can you see why Paul said, set your affection not on things in the earth? Do you see what Paul is talking about when he says, set your affection not on things in the earth? How do we take that as Christian mindset? That means don't think about fishing. Don't think about basketball games or don't think about a football game. Those are things in the earth. No, Paul was talking about don't set your things on the things in the earth. What was in the earth? The law, the temple, the priesthood, all the things of natural Israel. Don't set your things there, your affection there. Do what? Set your affection on things above. Now, I wrote this little note here. See the Jews, they sent their affection to the law, but here's the thing. The law was given of God to Moses. It was given to them. They didn't have something that was made up. They had the inspired word of God through Isaiah and Amos and all the prophets. They had the word of God, so it wasn't like they just made up something. They had something that was real, substantial, but they didn't know what to whom it spoke. So they went about to acquire and think they had a righteousness before God, that they could stand there before God and say, "Hey God, you remember, I'm one of your special children. I'm a Jew. I can stand here in that." I even hear Christians today say God had two covenants, one with the Jews and one with the Christians. It's not two covenants. Just one. Jesus is the way. He's the truth. He's the life. He's the resurrection. There's not another. It's Him. But I just wrote this out beside this word righteousness so I could picture it in my mind a little bit. I wrote light. Light. And you remember we were talking last time about Cain and the darkness and the reason people feel condemned. And all these scriptures, I'm just going to touch on these briefly. The reason that Paul said the works will be tried by fire, you know, and all these things to come into the Lord. Because when the Lord's presence begins to be felt, any of the darkness does what? It goes away automatically. It retreats. It goes into the corner. So whatever you are holding on to that is of the darkness can't stand in the light. Doesn't become the light. So when I'm thinking righteousness here, and that's why I wrote light out there, so I want you to understand here that we have a contrast. Because you know Jesus is the light. He said that out of His own mouth. I am the light. So they were attempting, if they were attempting to acquire righteousness, what are they attempting to do? They're attempting to change their state of being. Can a leper change his spots? I mean, we know that. How many times we say that? An old leper can't change a spot. Neither can darkness become light. The Gentiles, by faith, set their heart by the hearing of the gospel to know and experience the righteousness that was above the law or outside of the law. The spiritual reality for which the Jews themselves were even created. Israel, I've created thee. The Lord says that, I believe, in Isaiah. He created them. Jacob have I formed. Israel have I created. It may be vice versa. Created them for this thing. But Israel wanted to hold on to the law. And see, that's what we do. When I say we, this is all of us. Whatever we try to hold on to, we're rejecting Him. Because the substance is never joined to the flesh. It belongs to another. That is of the flesh is flesh. That is of the spirit is spirit. The scripture now will never leave my mind. It is rooted in there. I will be your God and you will be my people. That's why it gives so much power to the statement. We were born Jews. But even we, Peter, we received Jesus and believed on Him that we may be justified before God. Christ is the end of the law. He says in Romans 10, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. Not the cessation of it. And see, people get this wrong. Jesus come to fulfill the law. And I know what they think because I used to think it too. That means Jesus come to do it. Ain't what Jesus, when He says, I come to fulfill the law, it didn't mean I come to do it. And that's what people would think of. They would think, okay, so in not stealing, I'm fulfilling the law. In honoring mother and father, I'm fulfilling the law. I'm doing something. That ain't what Jesus meant when He said, I come to fulfill it. He stood there saying, I'm the one it pointed to. I'm the fulfillment of it. It's like you got a picture of a person. The fulfillment of the picture of the person is when the person stands there. That's the one to whom the picture spoke. what it means. That's the farthest point the law pointed to. It pointed no farther than Christ. Now think about what I just said. The law pointed no farther than Christ. Aren't people trying to imply that law today? Still yet? Making it be something else? When Jesus arrived, he was the goal for which the testimony had set out. It pointed to him, and he came, and nothing else beyond that. And that was his whole purpose. Everything given to Moses on the mountain, all the prophets, everything pointed to him. And when he came, it didn't speak of anything beyond that. It spoke of him. And Paul is saying, my God, the Gentiles and these Jews have received him. And you're wanting them to go back to the picture. The Jews had advantage. Much every way, the oracles of God were given to them. But what I mean by that, the picture was given to the Jews of Jesus. So it would be like, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking of an airport. You ever see an airport, somebody's got a sign right there and it says, I'm waiting, Tim Jesse. I've never seen Tim Jesse before, but I'm just going to hold a sign out. But it would be like I've never seen Tim Jesse, but I had a picture of Tim Jesse, and I gave the picture to you, and I said, go down there to the airport. He's flying in. You've never seen him before. You've never talked to him, never heard his voice. But here's a picture of him. He's going to show up at the 2:30 flight. When he gets off the plane, you're just watching. You're looking at the picture, looking at the picture, looking at the testimony, looking. And here he comes. Boom, you'll say, that's him right there. That was the advantage the Jews had. And here was the promises. And lo and behold, the angels began to sing. And here he was. Jesus even sent a prophet. The prophet, no greater than John the Baptist, said, behold, the Lamb of God. And the Jews looked at the picture, looked at him, and said, I think we'll just stay put. See what I mean? So he's telling, he's bringing this statement around to Peter, saying, now I want you to think about Peter. We were natural born Jews. Not sinners of the Gentiles, but we had the advantage. We had the pedigree. God separated us from that. I'll show you. He's saying, Peter, by your action, you're trying to bring these people back to the picture. Jesus said, tear this temple down, raise it up again in 3 days. What did the Jews say? Even the disciples here in Matthew 23, they wanted to take Jesus over there to the temple and show him. But Jesus is like, don't you get it? I mean, in John chapter 2, he says, this he spake of his body. So if he spake of his body as the temple, tear it down in 3 days and raise it up again, I got to ask you, is the temple raised? So then why are Christians and preachers on TV getting people to send money to natural Israel to get them to rebuild something when it's already raised? In glory. Now, if the righteousness of God, which is Christ Himself, lives in me, not me, but listen, if the righteousness of God, which is Jesus Christ, lives in me, then why do we still debate on long hair and dresses? It's pitiful. It's pitiful. God is saying, it's all dead, it's all unclean. Why are you trying to bring that stuff back in here? Let me get going here. I'm still here in Romans 3. The oracles of God were given to them. For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? In other words, the Jews having the picture, here comes Jesus standing there as the fulfillment of that. And they said, no, that's not him. Does that change God's promises? Does that make the promises of God of none effect? No, God promised it. It doesn't matter if they believed it or not. He sent his son. Didn't change anything. God promised it. God delivered. He promised it. He's going to fulfill it. Now, let me skip down to verse 9. What then? Are we better than they? We're talking about Jews and Gentiles here, aren't we? We had the advantage. We were the circumcision. We claimed Abraham to our father. And now Peter or Paul is saying, are we better than the Gentiles? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before proved both Jews and Gentiles that they're all under sin. Behold the Lamb of God, which does what? Taketh away the sins, plural? No, sin of the world. Now here we have this mark here. They're all under sin. He's not talking about what they're doing. We'll get to that. What they're doing is just a result of who they are. We'll get to that. As it is written, there is none righteous. No, not one. Jew or Gentile. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. With their tongues they have used to seek. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are their ways. The way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Sounds like exactly what we talked about before we started. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. And depart from evil understanding. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law. Here's why. That every mouth may be stopped, shut up, closed, can't say a word, and all the world may become guilty before God. Why? So that the need of Christ may be seen, may be grabbed a hold of, may be, just like the woman with the issue of blood, fought through everything to grab a hold because of her need. This is what the law was given to show, the need for this other life. The life that is freely given. That one. And what Paul has just stated here was the state of man. The state of man. Can adding circumcision to this man here who has poison under his tongue and cursing and bitterness and destruction and misery and no understanding, can adding circumcision to him make this man righteous? And this is not just the state that Israel was in, but that's the state that we're all in. Let me go back to Matthew and show you something here. Let's go back to Matthew 23. They have talked about this earlier. I'll cover it again real quick because it's relevant. Matthew 23. In verse 27, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. I may have talked about this before, but the reason they were said, you're like how did he put it? White sepulchers, whited sepulchers, they were whitewashed. Why would he say that? Because in Passover, all the Jews would come to Jerusalem. They had to. Every male had to go to Jerusalem. Well, they knew the Levitical law. They were natural-born Jews, and natural-born Jews couldn't touch a dead body. You were unclean. You didn't want to be called unclean before Passover, or you couldn't participate. So you couldn't even walk over a grave. You couldn't step over a dead man's bones. You couldn't touch a dead bird. You would be unclean, ceremonially unclean. So they went around to all the graves and washed them white so that when all the visiting Jews came in, they would know, don't step here, there's a body buried here. Don't step here, there's one buried here. Don't step here, there's one buried here. Because if they mistakenly, and see, it was up to the people, the living ones, to mark the graves so not to defile their neighbors. So I go out and I bury my dad out there. Then I got to go mark it white because here comes Kathy up in there. And if Kathy mistakenly steps on the grave, she can't participate in Passover. And it'd be my fault because I didn't mark it. Jesus said, you're pretty on the outside. You got it all marked on the outside. But within is what? It's full of dead man's bones. As I said before, the leper can't change his spots. The darkness doesn't become light. Apples don't become oranges. It's still the wrong seed. And the answer we know, we're going to get to that, is Galatians 2:20. You know, I'm crucified with Christ, and it's not take up your cross. It's already been done. The cross has already been taken up. You're baptized into his death. His death's already occurred. You're already dead. You are already dead. What do you mean already dead? Preachers ain't supposed to say that. Listen, you're dead, and Christ is your life. If Christ is not your life, then you have no life. It's just that simple. He is the life. If you're not partaking of him who is your life, you have no life. I mean, he said what? Come and dine. Let them come and drink. Whosoever will, let them come and drink of the water freely. But if you're not drinking of the water, now let me say, and we'll bring this thing to a close. The law applied to man is broken automatically, just like the tablets that Moses broke. When the law is applied to man, it is broken automatically. Doesn't depend on what I do or what I do not do. That's not what makes the breaking of the law. Because what have we been saying here? The law was a testimony of Jesus Christ. It was given that all the world's, their mouths may be stopped and the world may be guilty before God. I am what breaks the law. It's who I am. Paul seen that. That's why he said, oh, wretched man that I am, not wretched things that I do. Paul said, touching the law, blameless. He figured out it don't have a thing to do with what I do or don't do. It's who I am. And I have seen this as altogether another. And I'm not it. This didn't testify of me. This testified of another. And Jew, Gentile alike, need to partake of the free gift of God, which is Jesus Christ. What's the answer? Seeing the one who lives. By seeing the one who lives, I see that I don't live except I live by him. Now, let me show you something here. Just real quick. You know in Matthew, it said, Matthew 23, whited sepulchers. And what would happen if you touched the sepulcher, you would be unclean and not be able to participate in Passover, or for that matter, Pentecost and Tabernacles, because all three, all Israel had to come, all males had to come up. So if you touched one of those graves, you would be unclean. What is Jesus saying right here? Woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye, he's talking to natural Israel, right? He's saying, you are like those graves you painted out there. You look pretty on the outside, but you are full of dead men's bones. You are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. You are. You are just like those graves out there. Now think about what's happening here back in Galatians. What is Peter doing? Peter is going to the Gentiles, and now because of fear of the Jews who walked around in their self-righteousness, now the Jews don't want to touch the Gentiles. Because now we're going to fall back on our own righteousness. But Jesus is saying, you are just like the graves out there. You are just as unclean as the grave. Because you know what? What you have walking around is not life. Neither is that in the grave. I am the life, Jesus says. And except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. You're just like them. There's no difference between you walking around and that just buried over there. Second Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. That's not it. Went down the road. Let me try 1 Corinthians. Maybe that's... Oh, I'm in 1 Corinthians. Let me go to 2 Corinthians. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. Wonder what he's referring to. Because my God, have we not took that scripture and said that's unclean? Rock and roll music is unclean. Women wearing pants is unclean. Don't touch. What do you think Paul's referring to? Think of all these things I told you. What's the unclean thing? Jesus said, you, natural Jews, are pretty on the outside, but you are full of uncleanness. He's talking about the unclean thing is the natural law, the Judaism, the old covenant. Don't touch the old covenant. Be ye separate. Come out. Come out. Touch not the unclean thing. Don't try to come in here in your own self-righteousness. Don't come in here like the Jews of old did and try to stand there by natural lineage. We're the seed of Abraham. Look what I've done, Jesus. I've got 14 people baptized. I go to Bible study every day. Do not come up in here touching the unclean thing. Let's look at it in another place, Revelation 18. And verse 4, I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. Let me go back to Romans. I'm going to finish with this right here. Romans chapter 3. Here's the whole thing, Peter. Remember, Peter, we're natural Jews. Not the sinner Gentile people. All these things I'm going to bring you around, Peter, and I'm going to ask you the question right here that's put before us. I'm going to read chapter 3, verse 26. To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness. that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. That he might be righteous, not me. That he might be righteous. And then here's the question, Peter. Here's the question to them all. Where's boasting then? Hey, we can't boast that we're natural born Jews. Can't boast in circumcision. Where is boasting then? Where is it? Because we have concluded all under sin. That the whole world, that all their mouths may be stopped, that they all may be guilty before God. So where's boasting then? Where is boasting then? Peter, we're on equal ground here, my friend. We were all just like the Gentiles. We had the advantage, the oracles of God given to us, and our whole nation didn't even receive it. Where's boasting then, Peter? Where's boasting then, church? It's excluded. You know what that word excluded means? That means the door is shut. It's excluded, cut off. Then he says, by what law? By what law is boasting excluded? There's a law, there's a door here, and when boasting tries to come into the door, right, there's a door here. Here comes boasting, just going to walk up in there. But a law says, you can't come in here boasting. Kind of reminds me of that book, Hinds Feet. Boasting, you can't come in here. What are you doing here? You're excluded. The door is closed. Shut off. By what law then? Of works? No. By the law of faith. Why is it the law of faith? Because our kind. Our kind. Remember, Jesus is of a different kind. He is of another seed. We were seeds of many. He's the seed of one. He's the light. And if he's the light, then we're what? By nature, darkness. All under sin, darkness. So darkness can't come up in here by works and say, hey, I'm going to be partakers of the light. Uh-uh. But darkness stands back and looks around at all the other darkness and says, brother, I'm in need as much as you are. We're all in need of the same thing. Because he alone is the light. He alone is the righteousness of God. He alone is the glory of God. And we're all in need of him. Where's boasting then? It's excluded. By what law of works? No. But by the law of faith. And what is faith? We've talked about it so much. Faith is what? Faith is when it pleased God to reveal His Son to me. Faith is when we're beholding Him for who He is. This then is the message. God is darkness. Darkness is excluded at all. That's why He is made unto us all that He is. Because we're in need of all that He is. And this is the free gift. God Himself has made unto us all that He is. I'll be your God. You'll be my people. All right.